praise in this place. Come on, lift your voice like a trumpet. Bible says, cry loud and spare not, for the Lord is good. I said, the Lord is good, and his mercies endure longer than whatever it is you're going through. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah to the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world. Somebody ought to put your hands together. Glorify the great I am. Did anybody come with a praise? I mean, without the prompting of the preacher or the praise team, did anybody come with a praise? Hallelujah. Let's go before the mercy seat. Father, we bless you and we praise you because you are the Most High God. You are in a category and class all by yourself. You're God and God alone. And we rest in that knowledge to know that, God, we don't need approval from any man-made entity. That, God, you bless how you want to bless and move how you want to move. That you're sovereign and that you still have all power in your hand. Thank you, Jesus, for saving us and for giving us the right to the tree of life. God, we thank you that we don't have to make it by ourselves on this, in this cold, cruel world. But God, you have given us the advocate and the person of the Holy Spirit. And so, God, we thank you that you are already here. I pray, God, that you might tarry yet a little while longer so that sickness is dried up and miracles are made manifest and that signs and wonders are performed in our midst. God, we believe you to do the supernatural. We came to have an encounter with you. So have your way. Pour out your spirit. Be glorified, and we promise to praise you. It's in Jesus' name we want to say thank you. And all God's children said amen, amen, and thank God. Hallelujah. Help me thank God for our guest artists, our praise team. And that brother got a return trip. He got to come back. Amen. Grab your Bibles. We continue to stand and turn with me to Genesis 2 and 7. Genesis, the second chapter, the seventh verse. I'm reading out of the King James Version. I'm going old school with the those and the thys and the thines, all the things. Amen. Genesis 2, meet me there in verse number 7. Let's come on and read together as it appears on the screen. And the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul. That's not a lot. Let's redo it again. And the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground, breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul. Amen. Look at somebody, say, neighbor, I want you to know you've got the it factor. That's what I want to talk about. God bless you. Thank you for your cooperation. We continue today in the series we started a few weeks ago in the general heading Point of Order. Today I want to talk about the it factor. The it factor. The it factor, of course, y'all know, is that thing that makes all the difference in the world. Michael Jordan had it when he was playing. Lord knows he had it. And I'm not just talking about his leaping ability, his defensive prowess, but it was the drive that caused him to continue to push himself and his teammates forward until they won championship after championship. Oprah has it. Not just the it that caused people to watch while she was on TV, but she has the it factor in business, so she can spot a good deal and know how to negotiate something that's in her best interest. But we know that Prince had it. Lord knows Prince had it. He had on about 17 different instruments. He had it. Her, amen, she has it today. She's actually talented and can sing. We went to the reunion tour last week, and I come to tell y'all the Clark sisters still have it. Lord knows they still got it. You know, in entertainment, when you have that thing in your voice, when you move in a certain way, it arrests the attention of the audience, and we can't even put our finger on it. It's just something about you. And here's why I'm raising it, because listen, in all that God created, in all of earthly existence, Genesis 2 and 7 is written to let you and me know that we got it too. That God was intentional about giving humanity the it factor. We talked about how chapter 1 of Genesis basically gives us how God ordered the world into creation. And then, of course, chapter 2 begins by saying, and on the seventh day, God what? rested on the seventh day. Therefore, God blessed the seventh day and he sanctified it and he hallowed it. And therefore, the remainder of chapter 2 of Genesis, watch this, from verses 4 through the end, is really an artful retelling of the creation story. Now, watch real close. God is not erasing the world he just created in chapter 1. He's just giving us more information about what he did in chapter 1. Chapter 2 gives us more insight and understanding not only as to how the world operated, but he tells us more about what was occupying the world. He talks about how the world was watered, and then the writer explains to us that there was a special garden that God had created, and about the river that ran through the garden, and about the abundance of trees that filled that garden that the Bible says were both good to look at and good to eat. We know so much about what God did, but then when you get down to verse 7, we get insight into how man was created and the it factor that God gave us. Let me see if you picked it up when we read it. Let's do it one more time. And the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the ruach, the breath of life, and man became a living soul. That word living soul, a living being, most accurately, it might be translated life force. And all that happened because God breathed into man. Now for those who've been paying attention, that word actually is the second time in two chapters it's been used. Do you remember in chapter 1 where we hear about the ruach, the breath of God, the wind of God, the spirit of God? It's right there where it says, and darkness covered the face of the earth, and the spirit of God, the wind of God, that's right, the breath of God, what? Hovered over the deep. The same breath, the same spirit, the same wind that was covering the face of the deep is now breathed into the nostrils of humanity. I'm telling you, you can't get God's breath and not have the it factor. In fact, what you'll discover is that God, according to chapter 2, forms man from the dust. Now, don't read the Bible too fast because there's wordplay happening here. The word man in Hebrew is Adam. Adam, we call him Adam. But the word is Adam for man, and the word for earth is Adamah. Right? So when we say we're from the dust, the Hebrew language is making it clear. Oh, you're dust. You're dirty. You're of the earth. In fact, the feminine version of the word is Adamaha, which actually is from the red earth, like the blood. That God is making it absolutely clear that man has been formed of the dust. In fact, chapter 3 says, from the dust you were formed, and to the dust, you, when we commit bodies to the ground, ashes to ashes, and what? Dust to dust. You came from dust, and when it's all said and done, you're going to be dust again. And so the difference between your first dust and your last dust, the distance between your first dust and your last dust is spirit. Because man is formed of the dust, but he ain't man yet. He's not a living soul yet. What makes him a living soul is that God breathes into his nostrils the ruach, the breath. Okay, y'all still? All right, I was prepared because I knew there's going to be some of y'all like that. Uh-huh. So you remember your old Frankenstein movies? And Dr. Frankenstein had formed this monster, but the monster was catatonic. He did not move until lightning came and struck the rod. And when the lightning came through the rod and touched him, then he became alive. Never saw Franken. Okay. So in Marvel's The Avengers Civil War, got a multi-generational congregation. And Marvel's Avengers Civil War, when Vision is in the cradle, all of a sudden Thor comes in with his hammer and what? Calls down the lightning. And when the lightning touches Vision, all of a sudden he becomes alive. Are y'all with me? Please don't let me keep having to do this. What I'm trying to show you, my brothers and sisters, is that it's only when something supernatural hits that regular body that something becomes alive. And that's what God did for us when he breathed into us the breath of life, which is why, listen to me, mankind is the it factor of creation, because nobody else gets God's breath. God forms the plants, he forms the flowers, he forms the birds, he forms the animals, he forms the fish, but they are all formed from the earth because they're earthbound. But because our last home ain't earth, God has to put something eternal, God has to put something heavenly, God has to put something spiritual on the inside, and so he has to put himself in us, so he breathes into us, which means that we don't have peers with the animals. That's why he gives us dominion over the earth, that we will exercise, because we have a higher place in his creation. Are you hearing me? This is significant. Don't rush me now, because what I want you to understand is, once you understand the spiritual nature of the it factor, it's what makes you unique. See, here's what we know. You're not unique because you have intelligence and emotion and electronic impulses running up and down your nervous system, because you have instincts and neurons and DNA. That don't make you special on earth. Okay, pet lovers know that your dog has intelligence. Your dog has emotions. Your dog can be happy and sad and even express joy. And the fact of the matter is, you are not a peer to your dog, although some of y'all treat them like they people. Interestingly, most of the people that don't get along with people get along with animals. But Fido can't come visit you in the hospital. You better learn to get along with your own kind. Anyway, where I'm going with this, watch this, is that it's not your intelligence that makes you special. You are not a more intelligent animal. You are not a more emotional animal. You are a spiritual being. You have something that no other created entity has. And it's only when you begin to operate from your spiritual self that you align yourself to be able to experience the fullness of what God and life has to offer you. You better hear me. Bible says, Genesis 2:7, and the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground, breathed into his nostrils the ruach, the breath of life, and man became a living soul, which means humanity is different than all other species, number one. But number two, the question must be asked then, what makes us different within our own species? What makes me unique from the other 8 billion people on the planet? And the answer is clear. It's what I choose to do with my spiritual self. That it is only when I make choices consistent with the Creator's desire and design for my life that I have the ability to distinguish myself from the rest of the pack. And so here's my premise. I would argue that much of what we do in life is an attempt to get at this spiritual nature. We just trying to do it with all the wrong stuff. Whether it's the runner's high or the thrill of shopping or the adventure of extreme sports or the ecstasy of intercourse or the high of drug use or the haze of drinking or the desire for love or the need for fellowship or the dopamine release of likes and comments, the excitement and intrigue of gossip, we're looking for all this stuff to try to fulfill and satisfy the spiritual drive that's on the inside of us. But you need to hear me. There is a God-shaped hole on the inside of you, and there's no thing and there's no one that you can ever find to fill it. I need about 2 or 3 folks in here that could be honest about the fact that I ain't in church because I ain't been no place else. I've experienced what the world has to offer, and here's my assessment. I'd rather have Jesus than silver and gold. Do I have anybody in here that's had enough hangovers, had enough expensive trips, bought enough stuff just to see it depreciate, to say, I've tried what the world has to offer, and now I recognize it's only in Him that I live and move and have my very being. Give somebody a high five for the first time and say, neighbor, you are spiritual, and therefore you need stuff that's spiritual. You need the God of creation to fulfill and satisfy the need and the ache and the itch within your soul. Jesus said, that's why I came. I came that you might have life and that you might have it more abundantly. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. If you choose Jesus, Jesus comes into your heart, and He don't come by Himself. He brings His co-pilot, the Holy Spirit, so you don't have to operate on your own ability. You don't have to live by your five instincts like you're a dog or a cat, but you live like a man or a woman of God because He has given you Himself. And when you start operating in the power of the Holy Ghost, can I preach like I want to? But when you operate in the Spirit, life is different. Your spirit is that which gives you direction beyond your experience and education. Your spirit is what allows you uncommon resilience so that you have power to go through whatever is trying to drain you and take you down. When your tenacity and courage expire, the Spirit of God wells up in you and tells you, you better not quit. You better keep moving forward. You can do all things through Christ who strengthens you. Your spirit is that thing which allows you insight into matters that are beyond your access. That's the stuff that you know intuitively. There's stuff you know that you don't even know how you know, but you know. Because in the Spirit, God whispered into your spirit stuff that the Spirit was revealing to you. The Spirit will allow you influence with people that's beyond your personality type and your interpersonal communication skills. It's the favor of God on your life. You ain't that cute. You're that favored. Your spirit is what allows you, oh God, to know what is right from what is wrong. Your spirit tries to get you to avoid sin. And when you choose sin, your spirit is what allows you to feel shame so you don't make the mud your home, but you get up and brush yourself off and ask forgiveness and try to live right again. It is the Spirit of God that's on the inside of you that is God's own love language. It is the Spirit of God that gives you grace and gives you strength and gives you peace when all hell is breaking loose. When chaos and confusion arrive at your address, you're still able to sleep because God has given you a peace that surpasses all. I need about 500 folks that know that you got some spirit on the inside of you. You're more than your degrees. You're more than what your bank account says. You're more than your race. You're more than your gender. You're more than your relational status. You are a child of the Most High God. You are a royal priesthood, a holy nation. God has plans for you, plans to promote you, to provide you a way for your welfare and not for your harm. For the second time, give somebody a high five and say, neighbor, you got it. You got the it factor, and it's called the Holy Ghost. Here it is. On this Heritage Sunday, as we celebrate our biological lineage and our geographical background and our cultural lineage, I want you to understand that your true heritage is spiritual. Again, all people have a spirit, and all people will seek to fulfill the desire of their spirit. We just don't always use the right stuff to try to fill it. That's why when Christianity was formed, by the way, on the continent of Africa, it did not first go north to Europe. It first went south to Ethiopia, the land of the people of the burnt face. And And historically, our ancestors, like everyone else, engaged in various traditions and religions and practices because their desire was to get to know the God of creation. They just didn't know his name. Until finally, when we found the Word of God and the Word of God found us, when the Word of God got a hold of us, something supernatural happened sociologically because of what we had suffered in our journey. Let me do that again. How did our ancestors make it? Through the Middle Passage, through chattel slavery, through the ravages of the oppression that has been legal and economic and physical that has been meted out against black souls and black bodies for decades and centuries. How have we made it? We've made it because we have always been a spiritual people. We did not have the luxury to allow Christianity to operate as an ideology. Because of what we have gone through, we could not allow it to simply be a contemplative intellectual exercise. God had to be real in our lives because the devil was raising real trouble in our lives. That's why black church ain't like other churches. Because of what we've been through, we got to be real with God so that God can be real with us. The reason we do the most in church is because we've been through the most. So by the time we get to Sunday, it ain't time to just sit there and, that's a nice idea. The devil is a lie. After I done caught hell all week long, when I get to church on Sunday, I come to have an intellectual experience, an emotional experience, and a spiritual experience with God. I need the entirety of my being to be engaged in the power of God's presence in my life. Give somebody a high five. I think this is the second time, and say, neighbor, in the name of Jesus, I come to give my whole self over to God. See, when black folks read the Bible, we read it like nobody else could read it because we saw ourselves in Scripture. When we saw that the children of Israel had been taken into slavery and had been abused and oppressed, we saw ourselves in the Scriptures. When we read the New Testament and saw how the new believers were castigated because of what they believed and who they were, we saw ourselves in the Scripture. So don't ever allow anybody to tell you you serve in the white man's religion. The devil is a liar. It is historically inaccurate and sociologically inconsistent. The truth of the matter is, being black allows me to unlock the power of Scripture because I'm on every page where there's been somebody who's been least lost and left out. Look, a few years ago, Tammy, I was playing one of them video games with my daughter, Allie, and y'all, she was beating the brakes off them. She was wearing me out. And you know, your pastor's competitive. Pray for me. I'm competitive. And after a while, I started getting a little frustrated. And I said, now, baby, how are you doing this? I ain't that bad. How you just whooping me like this? And she said, Daddy, I'm just that good. And after a while, she saw it. She had this little smirk on her face. I said, baby, what's going on? She said, okay, the truth is, Daddy, I play this game all the time. And so while you were away, I was playing the game, and I got so good that it unlocked some special powers. So you can play all you want. You ain't gonna beat me because I got something you never got. Can I tell somebody up in here, the reason we're still alive in 2024 is because after all we've been through, after all we've suffered, after all we've struggled through, God has given us a supernatural capacity. Because if you've been through some stuff and you come out on the other side, you got a testimony. You got a testimony. Is there anybody here that knows if it had not been for the Lord on our side, we wouldn't be here as a people? But we don't die, we multiply. God keeps on strengthening us. God keeps on picking us up. God keeps on giving us another chance. And it won't be long till we go to a whole new. I'm telling you, if you're black, it helps you read the Bible, because worship in scripture was not catatonic. Read your Bible. There were no comfortable pews in the Old Testament temple, because standing and worshiping by bowing were the processes by which you gave glory to God. That they didn't tip God when they came to give sacrifices. They gave the best of what they had. They sang with loud voices. They brought string instruments and drums and horns. This stuff ain't new. We just doing what the Bible said. They danced and they began to shout because that was the way they expressed themselves, because God said, you shall serve the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your soul, and with all your strength. Read your Bible in the New Testament. The Bible says they gathered together by the thousands to receive the word of God. They performed miracles by the name of Jesus. And one day the disciples started shouting and the holy folk got an attitude and told, make them be quiet. You know, it don't take all that. And Jesus said, you don't know what you're asking for, because if I tell them to be quiet, you see all these rocks and stones and pebbles around here, they gonna start a praise party, because I've been a good God to my creation and everything I created has to worship me. And I need somebody in here to take a deep breath right now. Now let it out. By definition, you better give God praise, for the Bible says, let everything that has breath praise the Lord. I gotta get out of here. But the Bible says that God formed man from the dust, and then he breathed in him his ruach, his breath of life, and man became a living soul. For the third time, give somebody a high five and say, neighbor. Come on, say, neighbor. I come to church because this is the place where I become revived. The Bible says that he gave him the breath in Genesis 2, but he didn't stop breathing. In Ezekiel 37, the Bible says God took Ezekiel to a valley. It was full of dry bones. They were almost dust again. And God asked Ezekiel, can these bones live? Ezekiel said, Lord God, you know. And so God started working in the valley. He started putting the bones together. The hip bone got connected to the backbone, and the backbone got connected to the neck bone, but God wasn't done. Then he put flesh on the bones and organs in the bones, but the bones were still dead, because God had to do one more thing. Does anybody in this house know what God had to do to bring revival in the valley? The Bible says that God had to breathe, and when he sent the wind, the bodies came back to life. I need for the fourth time you to give somebody a high five and say, neighbor, I came to church to be revived. They've been working on my last nerve. The devil been trying to drive me crazy. My money's been making me stressed. But I came to church so I could receive the ruach, the breath of God, the wind of God, the spirit of God. Holy Spirit, come down and see about me. Ask me how I know, because on the day of Pentecost, can I preach like I want to? On the day of Pentecost, the Bible says they were all together on one accord in the upper room when the Holy Ghost came in, watch this, like a mighty rushing wind, and landed on each of them like a cloven tongue of fire, and they began to speak of the deeds of power. For the fifth time, give somebody a high five and say, neighbor, I keep touching you because I'm trying to get you to catch on fire. Now they looking at you like they got an attitude. That's the wrong neighbor. Find you somebody look like they got the Holy Ghost. I said, find you somebody look like they're happy in Jesus. Find you somebody that knows the joy of the Lord is their strength, and let them know that one can chase 1,000, but two can put 10,000 to flight. If your fire gets hooked up with my fire, we can change our house, we can change our schools, we can change our community, and we can change this country. Is there any? I gotta go. I didn't mean I didn't mean to hold y'all this long, but I like watching them survival shows. Not too many of us on them, mind you, but when I watch them, it's always the same thing. They gotta make fire, they gotta make the food, they gotta purify the water, they gotta stay warm. And so they go out and they find a spark, they make some sparks, and they put it on the tinder. And once they put it on the tinder, you know what they do, don't you? They blow on it, because the spark gotta get some wind if it's gonna become fire. For the sixth time, I need you to grab somebody and say, neighbor, I wish you would help me catch on fire. It's hard to catch on fire next to a wet Christian. It's hard to catch on fire with the super saints. Act like they too good to shout. Ask me this question. Did you wake yourself up this morning? Did you give yourself strength? Did you heal your body? Well, go ahead and set the record straight. Open up your mouth and pray and pray. Yeah. Yeah. I said, I wasn't gonna tell nobody, but I just can't keep it to myself when I think of the goodness, of the greatness of my God and all he's done for me. My soul cries out. Hallelujah, 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 ha ha, hallelujah to God. I'm done preaching, but can I ask you just one question? Ain't he all right? I said, ain't he all right? Can I ask you to touch one last person? This is the seventh person for the 7 days. Grab that neighbor, pull on them just a little bit, and say, neighbor, it's time to strike the fire. Can you help me bless Jesus? If you praise, I'll shout. If you shout, I'll clap. If you clap, I'll dance. You ain't got to praise him the way I praise him. But if God been good to you, if God made a way for you, come on, let's raise the roof, open up your mouth, yeah, yeah, yeah. I got time. You got praise. I got time. You got a reason to shout. Well, now is the hour when the true worshipers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth. Yeah. We'll be right back. You know, it's Heritage Sunday. And our grandparents used to sing a song that said, I wouldn't have religion, I couldn't feel sometime. We're spirit. And because we're spirit, we express it intellectually, emotionally, physically, with our entirety. Because the devil's not excluding places in your life. He can't get your mind, he'll get your heart. If he can't get your heart, he'll get your body. Sometimes he'll go for the whole thing. You better learn how to do the hokey pokey, put your whole self in. Shake it all about. Listen, I want to pray. I want to pray that we'll give ourselves fully over to God. Because that's the only thing that's going to satisfy our spiritual hunger. Can I pray that prayer for you? Father, in Jesus' name, I thank you right now that you have not left us lonely. You've not orphaned us in this world. But God, you gave us a spirit so that the Holy Spirit would have a connection place so he could live in us and we could live through him. So God, help us to stop cutting you off, quartering areas of our lives off. But God, we come to say right now, create in us a clean heart. Renew a right spirit within us. Our desire, God, is to seek after you. So God, I pray right now in this church, in this sanctuary, that you'll give us a hunger and thirst for righteousness. That we won't spend our waking hours chasing after stuff that still won't satisfy. But God, we know that you have the words of eternal life and that with you there is no failure. So now, God, I thank you for the fullness and the satisfaction that comes in relationship with you. And now, God, I pray for anybody who lacks that relationship, anybody who's unsaved or unsure about their salvation. God, won't you bring them forward that they might walk into salvation, to new life, eternal life, abundant life. God, allow them to know that Jesus will take up residence in their hearts and that he won't come alone, but the Holy Spirit will too. They can be saved today. Bring them forward. God, I also pray for those who are already saved, but honestly can't say they have a church home in the DMV where they're growing and getting stronger. God, bring them forward so they can put their roots down here so they can grow into all that you have in store for them. Finally, anybody who needs to rededicate themselves to you, they've fallen off or drifted away, maybe they even walked away. God, whatever the circumstance, you said you're married to the backslider. So bring them forward and have them rededicate themselves to you. We believe it for the harvest. It's in Jesus' name. We want to say thank you. All God's children said amen.